In this demo, we want to show how to add the next refinement to our growing person class, and that is adding its accessors and mutators. Remember that at the head of our file, we've got the one instance variable so far, a private string first name, and so by object-oriented convention in a well-designed Java class, the only way to get at this private information is through public accessors and mutators. So let's go ahead and add those methods in this section right here. And these always come in pairs, so we will add a placeholder for a first name accessor and a first name mutator. And accessors and mutators, simple versions, are literally simple one-line methods. So for an accessor, we're pulling the variable out, so it's always public. We're returning a string to the caller, and by convention, we begin those with get and the name of the instance variable. And notice that here, instead of a lowercase f, we've capitalized that to a capital F to maintain the camel case naming. And for an accessor, it takes no inputs, open and close curly braces, and the inside of it is literally just return a copy of the instance variable. A mutator is a similar thing in reverse. Its job is to change the value of the instance variable. So it's going to be public. It doesn't return anything to the caller, so it's a void. And by convention, it begins with a set and then the name of the instance variable, like so, with the initial letter capitalized to maintain camel case naming of the method. And then this one is going to take an argument. It's going to take an input of the same name as the instance variable. And this is the value that we want to set our instance variable to. So open brace, closing brace, and then inside, all we're going to do is this dot first name equals first name. And this was the use of that special this keyword, which helps us distinguish between first name as an input parameter, these two right here, and this is the full name of the instance variable. So now there's no confusion between the instance variable and this input parameter. So all we're doing is we're transferring the desired name into the instance variable. Seriously, simple accessors and mutators are literally one-line methods like this. Now we're going to do a few more things with a mutator, but for a starting point, this is all you need. Now notice what this mutator doesn't do. It doesn't prompt the user for any data. It simply accepts whatever is being given to it and transfers it into the instance variable. It's assuming that the outside caller gets that value in some fashion. So we don't want to turn this into a kitchen sink kind of solution with adding prompts or anything like that in here. If we want to get input from the user, what we'll do instead is we will add an alternate form or an overloaded mutator version, which prompts for the data, and it's going to look like this. It's going to have the same interface, public void set first name, but now instead of taking as its input the string we want to update our instance variable to, we're going to instead have a Boolean input flag. Let's call it input mode. And we're going to use this input flag to determine whether we want to prompt the user using scanner or a GUI pop-up using our existing utility file. So what we'll do now is we'll read in some input from the user, string data equals, and mine is called utils RL. Yours will have your initials, of course. And we're going to use the read string method. And then we're going to add a prompt and her first name. Make that a capital E. Whoops. Not typing so well today. Okay, so there's the prompt we're going to use. And This is the input mode we're going to use. So we're just taking this input flag and transferring it to this lower level call to our utility read string method. We're going to get a value back in data, and then all we're going to do with that is we're going to make a call to the other plain vanilla mutator using the value. So if we call this version, we're just going to say false for scanner or true for the GUI mode. It's going to use our utility to get a string from the user using this prompt and this input mode. It's going to return a value, and we're going to turn right around and pass this value to this nested call to this mutator up here, and it's going to set this instance variable up here. So again, don't try to do too much in a plain mutator. If you want to add embellishments or bells and whistles, it's better to add an overloaded form like this. So what we've done here is we've created what I'm going to call a prompting mutator. And if you notice this star here after the name of our file, it's been a little while since we've tried to test, or at least compile test, our changes. So in keeping with good practice, let's save this and compile it and make sure that we haven't introduced any errors, and we haven't. So finally, we said that when we made some changes, we should really add some test code and check out our updates incrementally. So remember that we've added at the bottom of this file a main method so that we can gradually add some incremental test code. Well, let's add on some test code for the accessor and mutator that we just created. So for example, let's do this. Let's print out. Let me back up here a little bit. We've already got a couple of objects set up, so let's grab this P2 object and use the accessor to pull the first name out of it, like so. There's a label. And then to get the first name from the P2 object, name of the object, whoops, that should be a plus, P2 dot get first name, open and close parentheses, closing parentheses, trailing semicolon. So this returns a string. We can only call it in the context of an existing object. So this entire expression is one string. So all we're doing here is we're printing out a label and some string value. And I will do this to add some blank space after our output. So let's save this, compile it, run it, and here is the output that we just generated. So let me do this. Let me put some blank spaces into the test code to space out the output. Save, compile, run. Okay, and notice that this system.out.println resulted in this blank space. So use these kind of statements liberally in your test code to make your output more readable. In similar fashion, let's also test our mutators, and we'll take our existing object and we'll set the first name to Dave, just like in the lecture materials, and we will use our print method now. And notice that we're going to use the messaging capability of print so that we can mutator, so that we can clearly identify what each incremental output represents. So again, we'll save, compile, run, give myself a little more space there. So here's our accessor output. We made a change to our object using this mutator, and now we're confirming that the change has taken hold and the name has changed from Fred to Dave, as it should. So now let's check our prompting mutator, and in this case it'll be set first name, but instead of providing a name, we're just going to provide the input mode type. So here I'm saying I want to use the false mode of read string. I want to be prompted for it using the scanner at the command line. And then we will print in the same fashion the object after the update. So let's annotate this output like so. And we will save it, compile it, and run it. And it's asking me for a first name, and I'm just going to use my own name, Rob. And then after we've made that change, we can see that it correctly updated it to Rob. Now there's one more thing I want to do here, and that's to make this a little more readable. Notice how we've got this organized. We've got related statements grouped together, and we're starting to put some comments in front of each of these blocks of code, and we have these blank line prints at the end of each test to space out the output here. So once again, let's save this, compile it, run it. It's asking me for the name, and it's making the change. Okay, so this is how we add accessors and mutators to our budding person class. Simple ones are very simple. A prompting mutator looks like this. And as always, when we add some new capability, we're going to add the corresponding test code. Again, remember, we're only doing all of this for our one instance variable. Once we get all these things in place, we're going to see very soon how easy it's going to be to extend this to all the instance variables. Finally, one more thing here. Now that I've got a version that works, I've made some incremental changes. What I want to do now is I want to save this off to a new snapshot. So we're going to save this off to PersonPhase6.java. So let's do a save as, and we'll call this PersonPhase6.java, save. It's telling me that the name of the class in here is still person. That's okay. I'm going to save it anyway. And now we've got this new file, PersonPhase6, that we can always revert back to if we make some mistakes. But this one right here, this is still considered the live version, person.java. So this is the one we'll continue to make our changes in. Okay? Just trying to introduce you to a good incremental development approach.